Hi everyone, in the last few days we have seen all kinds of information and analysis emerge about the sale of US treasuries, suggesting that China is beginning a process of de-dollarization, but is that really the case? Is China de-dollarizing or are there other problems that are leading it to sell these securities? In this video or analysis, rather, we're going to explore this question and analyze what's really behind China's decision to sell US Treasury securities. Let's find out together, and here you have the famous chart that everyone talks about to sell the narrative that, well, China, we are in de-dollarization and it is making an attack on the United States. We will now explore the question of whether China is de-dollarizing or whether there are other factors at play behind the sale of US treasuries. However, there is one crucial aspect that many analysts overlook: China's dollar liabilities. Let's delve into this topic and understand why it is vital to consider both assets and liabilities in dollars to fully understand China's financial situation. And above all this, it is important to understand why, in an international regulatory way, let's say, banks usually have offset assets with. Liabilities. So if there is an imbalance of assets, especially value, and liabilities, either due to monetary policies because there is distrust, because the financing mechanisms in dollars are becoming more expensive, making the value of the dollar rise, it can make an exchange rate mismatch in the price. Of what the renminbi is worth against the dollar, and that can create a problem, a very serious hole, with which both dollar balances have to be very well balanced. When we talk about the sale of US Treasury securities by China, many analyses focus only on the assets they own, in dollars that China owns, as we see that they constantly affect us in the three American Souths, but well, they don't talk about it either. Of the agencies, or even when they talk to us about these, notice now that China is selling, or let's say committing in repos values, they never tell you about what China has done before when it bought at the gates, and this is a process that is always seen regularly and when all the. These people who have to be obsessed with the dollar falling, don't worry, it's going to fall, but it's not going to be as fast as you think, because they never talk to you. When China previously bought, they bought dollars, but well, this is another topic, but it's good a little bit to, let's say, put in a little bit. As I was saying, this is always about the part of the assets, but never about the liabilities. However, one aspect that is overlooked is the other side of the coin, the dollar liabilities that China holds. Especially, and when I talk about this, not only central banks, but banks and also non-bank financial institutions, which is shadow banking, etc. It has, especially in terms of debts that must be paid in dollars. These debts represent a significant portion of China's financial obligations and play a crucial role in its current economic situation. A report by the Bank for International Settlements, the BIS, describes in a clear and concise way how these liabilities in dollars are affecting the Chinese economy, and let me share with you a relevant excerpt from the report that I think is very, very important, because already in 2018 there was talk of a recession in China. I think that with the pandemic many things were overshadowed, but before the pandemic there was already talk that there were problems, many debt problems that China had, especially foreign debt in dollars. This was already being talked about, and above all a lot of shadow banking. And here we will see how this report from 2018 or 2019, because it was updated shortly before the pandemic, is going to explain very well on the liabilities part the problems that we are now seeing in China. So we go to the BIS report that says in 2017 and early 2018, as US monetary policy tightened, this is true, even more against a backdrop of weakening Chinese growth, the US dollar appreciated and borrowing costs in both dollars and US dollars.
Debilitamiento del crecimiento chino, el dólar estadounidense se apreciaba y los costos de endeudamiento tanto en dólares como
US and renminbi increased. In this context, defaults on Chinese corporate bonds in both US dollars and renminbi rose sharply in 2018, albeit from very low levels. In addition, about $488 billion in US dollar denominated bonds issued by Chinese companies are projected to mature over the next 5 years. Real estate developers in particular face $80 billion in US dollar debt maturing by the end of 2021.
Millones de deudas en dólares estadounidenses que vencen para finales de 2021.
By the way, these Chinese promoters or developers issue bonds in dollars and then they don't have either natural hedge for dollar inflows or synthetic hedges. That is, they are issuing bonds in dollars without having currency hedged, and if the dollar strengthens and we have problems, here comes the question we have.
Y si el dólar se fortalece y tenemos problemas, aquí viene la cuestión.
Dollar financing issues, these bonds are going to default, and it's something that we've seen at Evergrande, that we're seeing in all Chinese developers and real estate companies. And this is important to understand because here there are also a lot of debts that Chinese banks are exposed to these real estate developers.
Que están expuestos los bancos chinos a estos desarrolladores inmobiliarios.
And this leads to a situation of monetary deflation. Why don't they trust them? Families who are seeing their savings in the real estate sector plummet do not want to borrow, and the banks themselves do not want to lend. So this is a serious problem of monetary deflation, and this is, as we see, the BIS was already giving a pretty exact hint of what was to come. So, as I was saying, real estate developers in particular face $80 billion in US dollar debt maturing by the end of 2021 and another $165 billion in renminbi debt. Difficulties in refinancing these US dollar-denominated bonds pose direct risks to the solvency of indebted Chinese companies and could lead to losses for other investment banks with significant exposures to these borrowers. This is what I was saying about the issuance of these bonds, and this can cause a very serious contagion effect. But that's not the end of the story. China has also emerged as a major dollar lender on the global Belt and Road, especially to low and middle income countries. This is important, because if China already has a problem of monetary deflation, it has to sell treasury securities in order to defend the devaluation of the renminbi with that monetary deflation. By having financed in the Belt and Road, because basically I am going to continue to finish this part, by financing or to be an intermediary in dollars, because it is going to have a problem that if also due to exposure to the dollar of other economies they begin to fail, it will have a problem. A problem of default in those claims of the border companies, those assets, those loans that they make through the bail and roll, even though they have as collateral, as you will see that Lewis comes to explain, raw materials, and this is a serious problem because when you become an intermediary and you do not have financing. As direct as it can be through a liquidity swap through the Federal Reserve, and you have to do it through a FIMARPO, that is, locking up treasury securities that are obviously not going to appear on the balance sheet as a pool of contingent assets that you can use. Freely to sell, no. These are going to be totally paralyzed in that FIMARPO, they can't be used basically for more things, that's going to reduce more and more their contingent assets, that balance sheet in which they can use to sell and get dollars, and this creates an effect of tension As you say, especially in the Chinese economy, many of these loans are backed by collateral in the form of commodities. I'm not saying that Bell Android is bad, I'm just saying that it's been too sweet. And this is not a very different stance than what the United States does. Yes, the US does it through violence, whatever we want, but China is also doing the same thing in another way. Which adds another layer of complexity to China's financial situation and its interactions in the global economy, as I have well discussed, I explained a moment ago. Since the global financial crisis, regulations have been put in place that could hinder dollar funding, especially for US banks that have reduced dollar deposits abroad. In fact, in the event of a shock to the euro-dollar market, U.S. banks would not be as directly affected by offshore dollar lending. This situation has created significant pressure on dollar funding since 2008. We have moved from a system of direct dollar funding through loans to a system of funding through markets, using mechanisms such as repo, commercial paper and currency swaps. In addition, we have witnessed a phenomenon of diversification in offshore financing. Funding is now based more on the recording of dollar funding liabilities locally, recorded locally, as I said, but mostly funded cross-border. This diversification has mitigated risks, as although the majority of funding comes from U.S. residents, i.e., U.S. investors, funding through local investors has increased considerably. This has created resistance, as U.S. investors are less affected by dollar funding mechanisms than U.S. investors, who might be forced to cut off funding due to their own dollar constraints. In fact, even dollar funding through affiliates and subsidiaries of non-U.S. banks on U.S. soil has declined, reducing the volume of European banks and pulling against U.S. banks, especially Japanese ones that have swelled and replaced European and British banks.
Especialmente los japoneses que han aumentado y sustituido a bancos europeos y británicos.
This has led to the flow of cross-border dollar funding being vital. The lack of data in the over-the-counter, OTC, financing markets creates a hidden risk, and when the dollar becomes more expensive, it indicates difficulties in dollar financing mechanisms. And this is something that we are seeing and today I have shared today, which is Wednesday, May 29th, 2024, so that the date remains, okay? So that this is not extrapolated with another date or remains timeless, but the date on which this analysis was made indicates that we are seeing precisely Japan, also the Asian part and as I have commented in other analyses and many times in my life, where it has increased the most is.
También la parte asiática y como he comentado en otros análisis y muchas veces en mi directo, donde ha aumentado más es la
The Asian part of the euro dollar, especially dollar loans, financing through dollar currency swaps is on the Asian side. That's where we're seeing just the pressure and a lot of the problems with all of this is that we don't have data, we don't have a lot of data on.
El problema de todo esto es que no tenemos datos.
All the OTC part we don't have data and we lack a lot of data so the exposure can be much larger and what we are seeing what is happening in Asian currencies that covered interest parity that I was already messing up because it indicates this. The pressure indicates to us these financing problems and these problems that exist in China and, as always, in the currency markets, they are much more sensitive and indicate much better what is happening in real time. In the case of China, a concentration of dollar liabilities in sectors such as real estate that makes hedging in dollars more expensive, either through inflows in dollars or synthetic hedging, leaves the country exposed to financing problems, as I mentioned. Above all, promising real estate developers or real estate developers do not have coverage in dollars and this is very serious if the dollar starts to rise and this is what we are seeing and what happened during the pandemic is what we did when the dollar was rising, when the financing mechanisms were not available. In dollars they were paralyzed and caused the dollar to rise, either because of the restrictions of the headquarters, because of the counterparties who have to lend, the investors who have to lend, the banks that have to lend do not trust, there is no circulation of collateral, even, as Angel said. Santana, the primary brokers themselves who are affiliates of the banks that mediate in these exchange operations, are restricted and if they see risk they will not lend.
En estas operaciones de intercambio, pues se ven restringidos y si ven riesgo no van a prestar.
And if interest rates or monetary policies in the United States are increasing, also increasing the SOFR rate, which is the rate, the benchmark for swaps and all these financing mechanisms, this is going to fail, the system is going to fail, it is going to create all these.
Va a fallar, va a fallar el sistema, va a crear todos estos problemas.
Problems and especially when you don't have coverage, whether natural, because in the case of Chinese real estate there are no dollars coming in and there is no synthetic coverage either.
No entran dólares. Y tampoco hay una cobertura sintética.
In the case of China.
Ya me estaba. Sí. Exacto.
This is aggravated by its role in brokering dollars for countries that do not have, and this is important, direct access to the Federal Reserve, lack of access to liquidity swaps, and participation in repo firms that lock in U.S. Treasury securities as in this. As I've been explaining, this is important. It locks Treasury securities on the balance sheet and exerts additional pressure. So China sees that the reduction of its balance sheet of 3 euros, either by, let's say, blocking.
China, vemos que la reducción de su balance de tresoros, ya sea por, digamos, por bloqueo de
stock repo and sale because it is necessary to contain that the renminbi does not collapse in an accelerated way but try to make it collapse gradually to be able to adapt a little bit to the situation in which you have.
De forma gradual para poder ir adaptando un poquito la situación en la que tienes.
This is key and this represents why if you don't have access, and this is already a geopolitical problem. Let's say, if you don't have access to those liquidity swaps, you're not going to have broader liquidity conditions and be able to cushion all these problems as if you can. European banks, Canadian banks, Swiss banks or Japan. This contagion, although this is not a guarantee, even having American investors, is not a guarantee that there cannot be a shock. If you can make it more resistant, but it also doesn't guarantee or, let's say, 100% guarantee that you're not going to have problems. If this continues to be caused over time, because liquidity swaps are also much shorter agreements, they are not for the longest term, it is to, let's say, suppress volatility and contain liquidity problems in the short term, but other types of measures must be taken, they are like a raft. When there is a funding problem, so it's important to understand when Powell is in the last few meetings, he always talks about the dollar funding issues. This contagion affects the Chinese sector, which has a high exposure to the real estate market and has created many offshore dollar loans and dollar bond issuances. This forces the Chinese to restrict their lending, Chinese banks to restrict their lending, which creates currency diffraction in China, which I've been explaining. The lack of dollar hedging increases pressure on the renminbi, forcing the PBOC, the People's Bank of China, to sell treasury securities to support a controlled depreciation of the currency and commit more repo securities to balance contingent assets. That is, try to keep your pool of contingent assets from emptying too quickly. Because it has to have at least 6 months of reserves in this pool, especially in imports, so as not to have problems, above all, with ratios for rating agencies. And this is important to understand. Imagine what it would be like if the cobaltification agencies sent Chinese bonds, whether in dollars or renminbi, to the absolute trash. It would be absolute chaos for China. Even the increase in the holding of gold, both in the Central Bank of China and, or curiously the citizens, as I explained and said and the BIS explained well, those problems of the collapse of the real estate sector where they have their greatest savings, presents problems in the situation, as I was even saying, the rise in the gold trend presents problems in China's economic situation, where citizens have seen their main form of savings through the real estate sector deteriorate. The reaction of local governments and communist parties by reducing regulations and restrictions, especially in the real estate sector, indicates that the most internal and it is not a matter of de-dollarization and also understand all that flow-outflow, let's say the BIS calls it claims and here across border claims that. China has foreign investors and those flows going out rather than entering China. This is a very important and serious problem. Especially China has a problem of inflow of dollars, which is what we are seeing, more than a de-dollarization, it is very short of dollars. Finally, it is also important to understand that exposure to dollars gives access to the most liquid markets and the largest number of more reliable investors. So in order to finance economic growth, it is important to have access to investors in dollars and markets in dollars.
Para financiar crecimientos de economías es importante tener acceso a inversores en dólares y mercados en dólares.
This is important and it is important because many companies are dying to open or to be on the Standard & Poor's, NASDAQ, etc.
estar en el Standard & Poor's, en Nasdaq, etc.
So, nothing. So far the analysis, this analysis already scripted. I hope it is much better, that this analysis is a little better and nothing. Remember, if you like this content, this type of analysis that I have created, well, nothing. Click on the like and subscribe to the channel. So nothing. Ciao. See you later, friends. Closed captioning by the Amara.org community.